Give me money, give me money, give me money, give me money, give me money.
Oh, dear Lord. Season 6 of MLP was actually pretty good, so much so I struggled to fill the worst list. Season 7 was considerably worst and provoked me to add the blandest 5 to the year countdown. Season 8, however, was so jam-packed with garbage that the first 4 entries on the worst list now have 2 episodes to share. And we still have one season to go. Is it too late to find another career?
You have your uses, don't you?
You all know I love Sheldon, and I'll protect him like Sourfang protects Zappy Boy, or Sylvanas protects the entire Horde, so an episode vaguely alluding to him and doing so specifically to piss Pinky off was right up my alley. The thing I find funny is that the fandom hated Mudbriar just as much as Pinky did, but they missed the point that Pinky inevitably got. Mudbriar didn't do anything. He just corrected Pinky a few times. How much of a little brat are you that this is contentious? But the real highlight of the mod couple is that it's one of the few episodes to take Pinky's aggressive neediness and actively discourage it. This has always been something Friendship is Magic and indeed a lot of modern cartoons struggle with, discouraging unhealthy behavior rather than enabling it.
What a bore.
One of the biggest problems with Friendship is Magic in recent seasons is that it takes a very strange and almost religious view of friendship itself, and generally doesn't have room for different kinds of relationships. It has one ideal of friendship, and if something doesn't conform to it, then there are problems. Enter the End in Friend, where Twilight attempts to display the virtues of her narrow-minded idea of friendship by spotlighting a relationship that is extremely low on direct interaction. Rainbow Dash and Rarity don't interact much in the show, largely because they have vastly disparate interests. Twilight tries to use them to prove that people with disparate interests can get along, but she, along with the writers, fails to grasp that the reason they get along is because their disparate interests mean they don't cross paths with each other often. Now that they're forced to be around each other, all hell breaks loose. You could make the argument that this means their friendship is toxic and unhealthy, but that would require you being a fucking idiot. Their friendship was fine until Twilight forced it out of the environment it was best suited for. You can tell that the writers are trying really hard to justify the school of friendship, and they're trying so hard that they're tearing characters apart in order to do it, and this demonstrates how drunk the writers are on lore because they're expending so much effort to sell you on the school of friendship that they're forgetting that My Little Pony was already a school of friendship before they started turning Twilight into a fucking missionary.
You disgust me.
I guess the ending of Marks for Effort before it even happened. No joke, when Twilight started hurling crazy accusations not based in reality when any passing glance at Cozy Glow's test would have made it clear that she was failing deliberately, I immediately guessed that Starlight was going to be the one to fix everything. Especially since she spent the start of the episode complaining that she felt useless. Once again, the show handicaps other characters for the express purpose of shilling Starlight Glimmer. Nearly every episode that features her, with the exception of every little thing she does, always has people either being inexplicably taken down or taking a level in stupid just so Starlight can be special. A matter of principles is no different. Starlight is temporarily put in charge of the school because she's fucking the princess, and Discord is mad about that. A matter of principles takes things to a further degree by continuing the lie that Discord is mysterious. The episode would have been solved in 5 minutes if even one person remembered that Discord is the most transparent, least mysterious character in the world. It's like when people pretend that Starlight has a silver tongue. I mean, she definitely has a ribbed tongue at least, otherwise Twilight wouldn't shower her in so much privilege.
That will suffice.
I'm okay with episodes that try to address puberty, since the 6-year-olds who were watching My Little Pony in season 1 are 14 now, and I'd say Meltdown handled it pretty well. I mean, Spike doesn't develop the dark powers of the underworld, which will lead to season 8's villain, who thinks friendship is a weakness until they're smacked by Princess Twilight's golden horseshoe, which is what I've come to expect from My Little Pony these days, nor is it low-key the creator's wank fodder, which I've come to expect from Steven Universe. It's just a solid episode about Spike breaking out into symptoms of puberty and having to deal with it, including the emotional turmoil that his mom might send him away because of his BO and an eagle kidnapping both his mom and her girlfriend.
Hardly worth the effort.
Oh hey, Hasbro remembered that they cast a bunch of kids and finally did an episode about them. Cool. I'll be honest, I was only half paying attention to what lies beneath because the Student 6 just aren't that interesting. Which I suppose makes the argument that this belongs in the number one blandest spot, but I'm too bored to care.
I was looking for a target, and here you are.
Twilight spends the entirety of Friendship University being jealous of Flim and Flam. She says she's not, but she is. The thing about Friendship University is that it reinforces another major problem with Friendship is Magic, in that these days Twilight is kind of a fucking lunatic, and she only gets away with it because the story is artificially stacked in her favor. Like how, despite Twilight being completely reckless and unable to manage a school, she's automatically right because the only person calling her out is also a xenophobe. In Friendship University, she accuses Flim and Flam of running a scam school with absolutely no proof, and scrapes by entirely on the fact that it actually was a scam, thus justifying her gross behavior by by sheer happenstance. This is a consistent problem with Twilight. She'll often heap mountains of accusation on someone with no proof just because they were a minor antagonist in a previous episode, and this never really jives with her scary eagerness to forgive and exonerate people who've committed far worse crimes. I echo what Sketchy said about Twilight in this situation. If you're gonna be a bitch, at least be consistent in regards to being a bitch. This is the kind of crap that's gonna get you strangled to death by a banshee. This is even worse than No Second Prances, because at least there, Twilight's obscene and gross displays of favoritism was a problem that she had to learn to stop doing. Here, she's just being validated. Here's something to always remember in regards to any justification you might make of this and other episodes. The writers chose for it to be a scam. They didn't have to do that. Speaking of which, when I talk about there being too many snapshot redemptions in cartoons these days, a lot of people will take the first instance of a show not doing that and hold it up as praise. And so School Raze was shoved in my face as evidence of improvement on the part of the writers. So Chrysalis, having been set up as a villain since season 6, returns and tries to use a bunch of sacred artifacts being held in Twilight School in order to destroy all magic in Equestria, whereupon she's captured and sealed in Tartarus for her crimes. Sorry, did I say Chrysalis? I meant Cozy Glow. Yes, apparently out of the two characters already set up as antagonists for such a grand act of villainy, the writers opted to make an actual literal child perform such a horrendous act instead. Why they chose Cozy Glow for this, I will never understand, but the act of them finally breaking the cycle of constant and instantaneous redemption by putting a literal child in hell is a level of failure that's almost funny. Like, adults who try to take over the world, destroy the kingdom, kill a bunch of people, and join a fascist cult can totally be forgiven, but a fucking child is going to burn in hell.
But she didn't show remorse while the others did.
Bitch, that doesn't answer the question of why they chose Cozy Glow instead of Chrysalis. Oh, and the alt-right pony from the season premiere got redeemed, so they couldn't even stick to no villain redemptions. This is the kind of story you write when you want to tell the people criticizing you to go fuck themselves. The whole episode is made of spite. As I've said for years, Hasbro is proud of their villains in recent seasons, and they don't like it when it isn't received well. This is the kind of story you write so that when Sylvanas sets fire to the entire country, you just don't give a shit because they haven't earned any sympathy from you. This is the kind of story you write when you're trying to get fired.
You look like you could actually be of use here.
Insert Golden Girls joke here, and away we go! Granny's Gone Wild is what the vast majority of MLP-related episodes should be. Fun, character-driven, and organically delivers its main theme. The kind of episode Friendship is Magic has built itself on, and yet these days we have to practically beg for as the writers look on fanfiction for their next fan theory to steal. I never expected to like the Gold Horseshoe Gal since Granny Smith has been such a non-character, but goddamn, they were so much fun. They even hit on Trixie's father, which was funny. I mean, her father has better taste in women than she does.
You cannot be serious.
Oh, an episode about Celestia? Well, that sounds pretty... Wait, why is she such an airhead? I'm guessing this episode was working backward from the premise Celestia can't act would be funny, but good lord, this joke goes on too long and goes to such ridiculous extremes. Like, she doesn't even know what charades is. Just... Alright, it's inoffensive, but it's also just dull.
Give my regards to the endless dark.
Pinkie Pie is one of the worst track records with episodes in the series' lifespan, second only to Cunty Purple. Generally, episodes that focus on her as the central character are bad because the writers generally have a hard time grappling with the fact that Pinkie's behavior isn't exactly acceptable, and key among them is her aggressive need for constant reassurance. It takes a lot of effort to keep Pinkie happy, and if you don't, she starts tearing the world around her to shreds. Before Yakety Sax came out, the worst of these was Pinkie Pride, where Rainbow picks Weird Al to throw her birthday party, and Pinkie gets upset and starts singing her own emo song, which the fandom loved for some reason. But then comes Yakety Sax, all those problems but worse because Pinkie loses her goddamn mind after being told she's not good at the Ovidaphone, flies into a depression, and then beyond all reason is coddled and encouraged to continue doing something that is making her friends miserable. This is a far cry from the mod couple where Pinkie's horrible behavior was actually discouraged for once, where someone sat her down and said that her ridiculous overreactions are not acceptable and she needs to stop doing it. Like with modern villains, Pinkie's insecurities about her friends not liking her are born from nothing. If Pinkie's neediness was preceded by something bad actually happening to her, to be a lot more understandable, but she seemingly has this insecurity for no reason whatsoever, and that results in her being a bitch until the episode just decides she wasn't actually being a bitch. Speaking of which, The Washouts features an inverse of the problems with parental guidance. Rainbow spends half the episode being a jealous bitch because Scootaloo has a new interest in The Washouts, but once it's clear that The Washouts are effectively Wonderbolt dropouts who do extremely unsafe and suicidal stunts, behave like complete fucking jackasses, and are generally about as pleasant as barbed wire bathroom tissue, then suddenly the plot does a complete 180 and Rainbow goes from being the fucking worst to being the designated hero. I mean, I guess that's necessary because the Washouts are all a bunch of aggressive, sniveling, easily provoked children in adult bodies, and literally anybody who looks up to them is in desperate need of a swift intervention, but it would help if the writers didn't needlessly spend half of the first episode hanging on Rainbow's tantrum. Like, pick one, guys. Is Rainbow a jealous bitch or a concerned mother? But the washouts really are garbage. Seriously, the washouts look like the kind of people who would glorify hazing. The washouts look like they would sue someone who looked at them funny. The washouts look like they would have a history of dismissive and hostile behavior and then act like the victimized party when their bile ends up completely backfiring on them. The washouts look like self-obsessed, borderline creepy blowhards that hide behind rabid mobs and underhanded, intellectually dishonest accusatory rhetoric to avoid the simple fact that they deserved all the ridicule they've unquestionably earned.
Glory to the Forsaken.
I think at this point I have to start disqualifying Fluttershy episodes because they so frequently sweep the competition. Fake it till you make it is one long string of Fluttershy being the absolute most and completely irritating even the worst of Manhattan's garbage citizenry and almost tanking Rarity's business entirely because she just got too into cosplay. Also, she's canonically 40 because she tried so hard to use internet slang and every word in that sentence was wrong. Just please never die, Fluttershy.
I will teach you restraint.
In keeping with the writers turning friendship from a tangible thing into a faith, Twilight opens the School of Friendship seemingly in spite of the series' own premise of being one in the first place. The vast majority of the episode is spent watching Twilight run it into the ground through her own ineptitude, blame the system rather than herself, and then just pull rank and do what she wants anyway, yada yada yada. Twilight has become the single most flanderized character in the series as the writers spend more time developing friendship as an equestrian philosophy rather than a universal thing. It was already kind of creepy the way the show portrays non-equestrians as violent savages until the equestrians bring civilization to their lands, but now it just gets bigger and bigger. Whatever happened to blasting someone with rainbows until they stop being dicks?
A clean death was more than you deserved.
The parent map is one of two episodes this season on the "this moral is disrespectful and will get someone killed" list. Starlight and Sunburst get sent to deal with their patronizing and disrespectful parents, yell at them, and then immediately make nice simply because the map demands it. This was only slightly less shitty than Parental Guidance, which means it's still extremely fucking shitty. Not helped by the fact that this time, instead of being overenthusiastic children, the parents in question have absolutely no respect for the very concept of personal space. The idea of Stellar Flare and Firelight raising children is terrifying. It'd be like letting Toon Critic Dr. Wolf and Josh raise children. Oh, but the parent map doesn't even begin to eclipse the hatred I have for On the Road to Friendship, or as I call it, Starlight is the fucking worst part 30. I'll spare you most of the details and just get right to the part you know I want to talk about. Starlight callously trades away Trixie's wagon without giving any regard to the fact that Trixie might have had a lot of sentimental value attached to it, and just didn't give two licks of a shit that it clearly hurt Trixie a great deal. I've said for a while that Starlight is the fucking worst, and you guys are no doubt sick of hearing it, but if you're sick of hearing it, why not get sick of the source, not the broadcaster? This is the fucking lowest she has ever gone, showing such a complete disregard for other people's things and actively getting angry when they complained about it. Throughout this whole goddamn scene, I was in absolute shock at the delusion playing out before me. Even more so when Trixie only got her wagon back because Starlight realized she couldn't pull it on her own, not because trading it away was a horrible, cruel, callous, evil thing to do. This episode puts Starlight's absolute callousness on display, and it is fucking ridiculous. This is something that would fit into season 6, but we're 3 years out from her supposed redemption, and she still hasn't learned a goddamn thing. She is still abusive and nasty to everyone she knows, Trixie more than anybody else. I really felt for Trixie when she started crying over the loss of her wagon, because that is a fucking horrible thing that Starlight has done to her. How much lower is this garbage horse going to sink with only one season left to go?
You're a guest in my home.
So one lesson that My Little Pony tends to hammer in over and over and over again is the importance of real communication. This doesn't bother me as much as other repetitive lessons because I've seen for myself that even grown-ass adults refuse to do it, stubbornly. So I'm all in favor of My Little Pony continuing to slam that particular railroad spike, and Sound of Silence is probably the best example of it so far, especially since the Kirins so accurately reflect the rest of the Brony fandom. I've talked about this before, but a lot of them are very socially maladjusted, and they really hate it when people argue and fight, and they'd rather everyone be quiet and get along. The Kirin do the same thing, except their anger also comes with them immolating themselves and burning things down, so there's a little bit more ground to stand on as for why they should all keep quiet than just delusions, but that ends up being the rod for their own back because, like a lot of people, they don't grasp that anger is a valid emotion, that anger isn't a horrible thing to be avoided, it just needs to be dealt with in a healthy way. But the Kirin, again, like a lot of people, don't accept that and they do everything they can to avoid anger. It's like an entire village of Silverquill. Obviously, the Kirin get over their aversion thanks to the intervention of Applejack and Fluttershy, and of course this episode worked out because Fluttershy's in it, and that seems to be all it takes for the writers to stop being shit for 5 minutes. Fluttershy and Applejack play off each other in this episode so well and so organically that I unironically ship Appleshy now. I prefix this by saying it was about communication, but really the episode is about not being afraid of your anger and treating it like every other emotion. A lesson that I think a lot of kids absolutely need to hear, because if the Brony fandom is any indication, then a lot of kids are being told the opposite, and we need to mitigate that damage.
Life is pain. Hope fails.
I don't get the fandom around Queen Chrysalis. She was fun for a while, sure, but when she appeared in Season 6, I was so disinterested I never actually bothered to watch Tawarin back again, and when she showed up again for Season 8, I was once again as bored as it could possibly be. The Mean Six features Chrysalis making an evil clone of the Main Six, and then bumbling around for the next 20 minutes, achieving nothing and not being funny. Only somebody who is still driven to cheers by simply seeing Chrysalis will enjoy this episode, and everyone else might as well not bother. Chrysalis' appeal was the almost boisterous way she presented herself at a Canterlot wedding, a presentation that really only works when she's winning. In the Mean Six, we're just watching her get mercilessly smacked around by Fate, which completely misses the point of what made Chrysalis interesting in the first place. In fact, I'm surprised that out of all the episodes that Chrysalis could have appeared in, they chose to waste her on this.
Burn it. Burn it!
Hey kids, what do you do if you repeatedly fail at everything you do because you give up after the first try? Kill yourself! Wait, what? I've heard some people claim that this episode is an allegory for contemplating suicide. It's not. It's a blatant depiction of somebody contemplating suicide. And Twilight only puts up minor resistance before finally giving in. I've been appalled at some of the stunts that the show staff have pulled in recent years, but this is the first time I've stood up and screamed, "What are you fucking doing?" Unfortunately, just like Do Princesses Dream of Magic Sheep, this is an episode that depicts someone who is in desperate need of psychiatric help, and yet the very concept is completely thrown out the window. The writers actually try to weasel their way out of it by claiming that petrification is temporary, and that's just even more offensive. The show just barely pulls out of its nosedive because of a bunch of kids said, "You matter to us and we'll be sad." The sad part is that this episode was doing okay until they introduced the turn me to stone thing. At that point, we went from zero to yikes in the span of 30 seconds. And the episode just kept going and treated something that is only slightly detached from fucking suicide with all the mundanity of Pinky's latest mope fest. Look, I've battled with suicide at different points in my life, in 2007, 2013, and 2018, and that sense of hopelessness that festers in your brain will not go away just because a few people paid you some attention specifically to postpone your death. It is a lot more fucking complicated than that, and the lack of respect the writers show to it is fucking offensive. When I eviscerated Do Princess's Dream of Magic Sheep for the way it handled depression and brought up this very point, there were no shortage of charity cases decrying me as an advocate of Big Pharma and bemoaning how antidepressants are fake happiness and how mental health treatment is just ableism pushed by neurotypicals. And I just want to take this aside to say fuck you very, very much. Medicine and doctors are good, you pretentious asshole. I'm sure all your friends told you that your mental illnesses don't need treating and that they're a core part of your very being, but that's a fucking lie you all tell yourselves because you're too fucking proud to admit you need help. Rockhoof in a Hard Place is absolutely fucking appalling and a clear sign that the writers have absolutely no regard whatsoever for the shit that's coming out of their mouths. Fuck this episode, fuck the people who wrote this episode, and if you try to defend this episode, fuck you too.